really is a gathering together of folks who are passionate about reading poetry and writing poetry. And our hope is that local poets and the members of the public who see so many wonderful people gathering together here may realize that if they haven't taken poetry into their lives, perhaps it's time they should. We try to find poets who are not only critically acclaimed, but are also excellent teachers. So finding really wonderful poets to feature at the festival, I think, is really the key to the whole thing working.
This is one of my favorite Lucille Clifton poems, Why Some People Be Mad at Me Sometimes. They ask me to remember, but they want me to remember their memories, and I keep on remembering mine.
I wish I had one of those stories like, oh, I've been writing since I was three, you know. And it was late, at least by academic standards. I enrolled in college as a chemistry major, and it wasn't until college, late college, when I encountered what I now know to be a prose poem. At the time, I didn't know what that was. I encountered a prose poem by Naomi Shihab Nye. And my schooling in poetry was so deficient. I didn't know there were any living poets, honestly. That's how embarrassed. I mean, this is my junior year in college. I did not know there were any living poets.
The heart of poetry is in metaphor. It is both the thing that makes poetry magical, but it is also the thing that, even if we're not conscious of it, it's the thing that we're after when we read a poem. We want to see something in fresh terms or see something in a way that we hadn't seen it before.
Oh, it's very intense. It's the most intense form of language and the oldest. It's probably the foundation of most religious practices. And we were born, humanity was born in song and chant and prayer and incantation. And as it evolved over time, poetry, through the epic, captured human history.
Oh, I suppose I was always drawn to language as a child and, you know, making up. My father still has poems that I wrote as early as the second or third grade. And I remember my third grade teacher and the librarian in my school binding a little group of poems that I had written and putting them in the school library.
You know, I mean, poetry for me is communication and, you know, being able to communicate my awe or wonderment or sadness or grief. And I'm, you know, I tell my students, if I don't want to, if I'm not interested in letting the reader be aware of that, to communicate that somehow, that's important too, but that's called diary writing. You know, don't inflict that on the world.
The easiest answer to that was just the freedom in it. I mean, I liked that I could write about anything and approach more or less any subject in any way. So that was probably the rawest part of my interest in poems. But beyond that, of course, what has sustained my interest, of course, is the idea that at any moment as a writer, you might stumble into something that's really true.
I'm a teacher, I'm a mother, I'm an activist, I'm a poet, but I've written poetry the longest, since I was 9 years old. I've edited anthologies of the poets who have endured conditions of extremity, serious imprisonment, censorship, exile, house arrest, life under military occupation, life in war zones, collected these works together so that they form a kind of history, anthological history of our time.
Well, the Minecraft talk was about metaphor as a kind of accelerant in poetry. I was talking about the idea that metaphor is the kind of the clearest manifestation of magic in language, to be able to make something suddenly visible that really doesn't exist, to make something that was previously known only kind of as a vague feeling suddenly becomes more concrete in a metaphor. That's what I was talking about, among other things.
It's because in poetry, language is compressed, and because it is musical, and because it is condensed, it is at its most powerful. Rilke called it the natural prayer of the human soul. And so you have this utterance, this human language on the thread of music, plumbing the depths of the human psyche. People recognize something in it they don't hear or see anywhere else.
There's a moment, I think, for some of us, many of the people that I met in my office talked about loving poetry as a child and then turning away from it when they were older, when we were forced to study it in a different kind of way, picking it apart in a way that diminished the pleasure that we have in the sounds of words and in language and its attendant music.
I write for the people who are like me, who was a scientist at heart, not in skill, and I was drawn to the words like hexavalent chromium in chemistry class. I love the beauty and the sound of that. And I don't want people to have advanced degrees and those people be the only people who understand my poetry. You know, I want people of all backgrounds to be able to get what I'm trying to say. Otherwise, why am I saying it out loud?
And so it took, I think, some remarkable things to get me to come back. And one of those was, I suppose, not only my attempt at writing poetry, but the coming back to being a reader and a lover of poetry, because I read in school W.H. Auden's Musée des Beaux-Arts about suffering. They were never wrong, the old masters. And it spoke to me about my own suffering, my own sort of loneliness in the world, that feeling of being so completely alone, and yet what the poem said to me was that I was not alone in my grief, that there was a sense of aloneness that the poem could capture that meant that my grief, my suffering, wasn't unique, and that I was part of a shared community across time and space of suffering. That didn't feel so alone anymore.